Our Heavenly Father, we give thanks we can meet. For some this Sabbath day, some the Sabbath day has ended, but we can give thanks that we have the technology to meet together and to look at the words of Ellen White concerning what she says about the parable of the 10 virgins, that we can have a deeper understanding of this year parable and its importance to us living at the end of the world and anticipating your soon coming. Pray this year study be edifying. I ask you guide me in this year study that I can present it in a way that is to your glory, and that we can be enlightened with your Holy Spirit deep within our hearts to know your transforming power and to have a greater appreciation of the light that you're sharing upon us as we approach the end of all things, and that we can be representatives to you in a world which is soon to perish. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, so this here presentation is really a review of this here document that I've been working on. I began it in January, and so it's been quite a while, doing bits here and there. And so it's a parable of 10 virgins as expounded by Ellen White. And we first look at there's like a short introduction, then there's the parable itself. We'll not read that because we'll cover that as we go on. There's differing applications that Ellen White makes. And then there's, so we have the first application that we find in Christ's object lessons. And then there's an application we find in the Great Controversy. And then we look at that parable and the history of the first and second angels' messages repeating. So we try to make sort of like that history repeating, first and second angels, and in connection with the parable. And then of the section there, 9/11, and the prophecy of the throwing down of the great buildings of New York. And then there's just a short section on the shut door to Sunday law that takes Ellen White's statements and sort of places like a closer probation, which like a shut door of the that we find in the parable. That there's an application there to the church at the Sunday law, and then an application at the when Michael stands up at the end of the world. These here page numbers would be different. I haven't really, I'd have to sort of work on changing that. But this here is adapted just for this presentation. There's probably things in this here document that wouldn't be for, like, this is more like an introduction for Adventists to look at 9/11 as a waymark. And so that's generally where we're looking to go. This year study, and this is just like a review of it. So I just say the aim of this study, it seeks to highlight the various ways the parable has been applied by Ellen White and to connect its story to events in the past and to the Seventh-day Adventist understanding of prophetic events in the future. In so doing, I will be at times making my own applications for consideration. The ultimate aim, by the help of the Holy Spirit, is for us to be inspired to be wise virgins with oil in our vessels, that when the great crisis before us confronts us, we may be able to have light. Have light on the path, or sorry, we may be able to have maybe at least some to light the path to the holy city for others and ourselves. So I think I have to correct something there. So I'm just going to make my grammar a bit better there. So just some comments about what Ellen White says about the parable. The parable of the 10 virgins was given by Christ himself, and every specification should be carefully studied. A time will come when the door will be shut. This representation should call forth our earnest study in order that we may know what preparation to make, that we may enter in and partake of the marriage supper of the Lamb. The parable of the wise and foolish virgins comes as a solemn warning to every church. So we're going to look at the differing applications. The parable, as expounded by Ellen White throughout her writings, has at least two applications. For example, the bride is applied as representing the church, but also the holy city. So I'm going to ask someone else just to read the rest of this page, if they could do that. Some volunteer, please.
Stephen, I can
go ahead.
Ellen, you go ahead. You have a really lovely reading voice.
The bride is the holy city. The bride represents the holy city. And the virgins that go out to meet the bridegroom are a symbol of the church. In the Revelation, the people of God are said to be the guests at the marriage supper. If guests, they cannot be represented also as the bride. The bride is the church. All the Christian world is represented in this parable. The bride constitutes the church. Very close and sacred is the relation between Christ and his church. He, the bridegroom, and the church, the bride. The bride is the church, who is waiting for the second appearing of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Three applications. In the following quote, we can see the potential for three applications for placing the parable in events in history. The parable has taken place, namely in the early 19th century with the Millerite movement. It will take place in the future at the end of the world. And that is taking place over a period of time from the Millerite movement to the end of the world. I am often referred to the parable of the 10 virgins, five of whom were wise and five foolish. This parable has been and will be fulfilled to the very letter, for it has a special application to this time. And like the third angel's message, has been fulfilled and will continue to be present truth till the close of time.
Okay, thank you, Ellen. So I just have a diagram just that represents that. It has been fulfilled, and we would understand that to be taking place from 1798 to 1844. And it will be so sometime in the future, you know, in this year, I'm not sort of, this is like an introduction, we know. We could maybe put 1989 there, and maybe the close of probation, or Michael stands up would be the end of that. And she also says it continues to be present truth. So when she's writing this here, I think it's like around the 1900s. So in a sense, it's still taking place. It's still relevant in some way to her time as well. So the parable as expounded in Christ's object lessons, this exposition does not show an emphasis on its past fulfillment in Millerite history, which would be the main exposition of the parable that we find in the Great Controversy. Rather, it is general, relating just to God's church at the end of the world. So we don't have to read this here at all, so we know there's a scene there, the Christ is with the disciples on the Mount of Olives. He's rebuked the Pharisees that day, and the sun's gone down, and he sees this here scene where these here virgins are waiting for the bridegroom at some location near the Mount of Olives. So verse 1 says, then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins robed in white, which took their lamps and a small flagon of oil and went forth to meet the bridegroom. So I've just taken that scripture and added some words from Ellen White, how she maybe elaborates it slightly more, just for us, we've got more information. So the virgins are called virgins because they profess a pure faith. A faith would be a pure faith would be a faith that does not hold the doctrines of Babylon, as does the evangelical Protestantism. Therefore, the virgins represent the Seventh-day Adventists. And then she says that to herself. She says, the parable of the 10 virgins of Matthew 25 illustrates the experience of the Adventist people. The lamps, you know, that's the word of God. The oil is the Holy Spirit. And the oil is the righteousness of Christ that represents his character. And there are five wise, five foolish. We know there's two classes of worshippers represented by that. And then the foolish took no oil. They have a form of truth. They have the lamp, but they have no oil in their vessels. The power of godly example is lacking. There's no living experience to give power to the truth presented. So we should be quite familiar with this, and it's just generally a brief overview of this year's section. And the wise took their oil and their vessels with their lamps, so they anticipated delay. They filled their flagons with oil, prepared for any emergency, and from those flagons, their lamps were supplied and not left to go out. So why is there a delay? The reason why the bridegroom delays is because he is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And then there's another example we could bring in is unbelief. We have that quote where she says that had the Adventists, after the great disappointment in 1844, held fast their faith and followed on unitedly in the opening providence of God, receiving the message of the third angel, and in the power of the Holy Spirit, proclaiming it to the world, the Lord would have wrought mightily with their efforts, and the work would have been completed, and Christ would have come ere this to receive his people to their reward. But in the period of doubt and uncertainty that followed the disappointment, many of the Advent believers yielded their faith. Thus the work was hindered, their world was left in darkness. For 40 years did unbelief, murmuring and rebellion shut out ancient Israel from the land of Canaan. The same sins have delayed the entrance of modern Israel into the heavenly Canaan. In neither case were the promises of God at fault. It is unbelief, the worldliness, unconsecration, and strife among the Lord's professed people that have kept us in this here world of sin and sorrow so many years. And if we were to read Revelation, I think it's 19, it says the bride has made herself ready. And I think that's why the Lord is tarrying. It's kind of the church hasn't been ready. So the bridegroom tarried and all slumbered and slept. So there's a time of waiting has intervened. And then the cry was made, go you out to meet him. The virgins arose, trimmed the wise. The 10 maidens trimmed their lamps and in haste to go forth. But five neglected to fill their ask with oil. They did not anticipate so long a delay. They were not prepared for the emergency and distress. The foolish said unto the wise, give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. So they are destitute of the Holy Spirit. Without the Spirit of God, a knowledge of his word is of no avail. The truth, the theory of truth, unaccompanied by the Holy Spirit, cannot quicken the soul or sanctify the heart. One may be familiar with the commands and promises of the Bible, but unless the Spirit of God sets the truth home, the character will not be transformed. Without the enlightenment of the Spirit, men will not be able to distinguish between truth from error, and they will fall under the masterful temptations of Satan. So, under the masterful temptations of Satan, I'm anticipating this is they are receiving strong delusions, or you could say that they're taking the mark of the beast in that application to the end of the world. Their lamps are either going out or either they are out. So Elmite says, when the call is made, they will arise at last to find that their lamps have gone out. So she says that in one application. And then she says the foolish virgins whose lamps were going out and there was no time in which to replenish their vessels with oil. So there's just kind of, I'm trying to fill in there, are they going out or are they out? Or I think just at that their stage, when they wake up, were the lamps already out or were they going out? So I'm not too sure, just kind of like two quotes there that seem to be contrary to each other. And then the foolish versions are unconverted yet profess to be Christians. So this is just, we know that they're not hypocrites. The foolish versions are likened to the stony ground hearers. So that's when the sun comes up, they don't have sufficient soil to sustain themselves. Their service to God degenerates to a form. They cry peace and safety is their message. And it is in the crisis that character is revealed. A sudden unlooked for calamity, something that brings a soul face to face with death, will show whether there's any real faith in the promises of God. So we know that calamity that would be represented by the Sunday law. So the great final test equates to the time when Michael shall stand up. So that, she says, the great final test comes at the close of human probation. But we had understand that as Adventists, the Sunday law, in a sense, when that comes, we need to be sort of ready for that. You know, we can't wait until, you know, the test doesn't come. That test, at the close of human probation, it's more like a litmus test. There's a three-step testing process that precedes that, which is, so it's a different type of test. Or the final test, the litmus test, would be the last step in that three tests. So verse 9 says, but the waiting wise, five wise, with their freshly trimmed lamps, have emptied their flagons, and they have no more oil to spare. And the answer saying, not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. Go ye rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves. So we must buy for ourselves. We must be not content with a mere profession, but to stand with principles of truth as part of our life. So just going through this here, just trying to pick the main points. So the Church of Laodicea is counseled to buy from the Lord gold tried in the fire. So the wise virgins receive oil for their lamps by discerning the source of their supply, and this is used for evangelism. So there's a quote there that sustains that there. There's another witness that the lamps of the wise represents evangelism and the gathering of the harvest at the end of the world. So maybe another volunteer just would like to maybe read that paragraph for me, please.
Starting at another.
So just from the light, their light burned.
Their light burned with undimmed flame through the night of watching. It helped to swell the illumination for the bridegroom's honor. Shining out in the darkness, it helped to illuminate the way to the home of the bridegroom, to the marriage feast. So the followers of Christ are to shed light in the darkness of the world. Through the Holy Spirit, God's word is a light as it becomes a transforming power in the life of the receiver. By implanting in their hearts the principle of his word, the Holy Spirit develops in men the attributes of God. The light of his glory, his character, is to shine forth in his followers. Thus they are to glorify God, to lighten the path to the bridegroom's home, to the city of God, and to the marriage supper of the Lamb.
Okay, thank you. So this is something that the wise versions are to do, which the foolish versions will not be able to. So while they went to verse 10, and while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, the procession moved on and left them behind. So the five with lamps joined the bridal train, and they that were ready went in the house with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. So they went to buy. So the application could be made that the foolish virgins, to be able to buy at this crisis point, would require them to take the mark of the beast. For no man may buy or sell, save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. So that would be an application I would be applying there. And then afterwards, the other virgins came saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But the foolish virgins reached the banqueting hall. They received an unexpected denial. He, the master of the feast, answered and said, "Verily I say unto you, I know you not." They were standing without in the empty street in the blackness of night. Saddest of all words was ever that ever fell on mortal ear, are those words of doom, "I know you not." The fellowship of the Spirit which you have slighted could alone make you one with the joyous throng at the marriage feast. In that scene you cannot participate. Its light would fall on blinded eyes, its melody upon deaf ears, its love and joy could awaken no chord of gladness in the world benumbed heart. You are shut out from heaven by your own unfitness for its companionship. In the following passage, we can find described the experience of the foolish virgins. They take the mark of the beast and begin to experience the seven last plagues with the wicked. They then plead the Lord for mercy, but it's too late. The foolish virgins, as described in early writings, page 36, paragraph 2. The context of the passage is after the close of probation, being the time of Jacob's trouble for the righteous. I was shown a company who were howling in agony. On their garments was written in large characters, "Thou art weighed in the balance and found wanting." I asked who this company were. The angel said, "These are they who have once kept the Sabbath, but have given it up." I heard them cry with a loud voice, "We have believed in thy coming and taught it with energy." And while they were speaking, their eyes would fall upon their garments and see their writing. And then they would wail aloud. I saw that they had drunk of the deep waters and fouled the residue with their feet. Their feet trodden the Sabbath underfoot, and that was why they were weighed in the balance and found wanting. So we can see that maybe applying to the foolish virgins who are then shut out. And you can say Judas had a similar experience. Could be typifying the foolish virgins there. And then we have, "Watch therefore, for you know not, neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh." The 10 virgins are all watching in the evening of this earth's history. All claim to be Christians. All have a call, a name, a lamp. All profess to be doing God's service. All apparently wait for Christ's appearing, but 5 are unready. 5 will be found surprised, dismayed outside the banquet hall. There's a statement there concerning the wise having light in the darkest hour. And then we have, at the second coming, the living saints go forth to meet the bridegroom. So we can place that in the parable at the second coming. She says there, "With lifted up heads, with bright beams of the Sun of Righteousness shining upon them, with rejoicing that the redemption draweth nigh, they, the living saints, go forth to meet the bridegroom, saying, Lo, this is our God, we have waited for him, and he will save us." This passage equates the living saints, namely the 144,000, with the wise virgins. Although the shut door for the 10 virgins as exposed in Christ's object lessons is at the close of probation, the five foolish were without oil. When the Sunday law crisis began, it was too late for them at that time to supply the lack. Therefore, it was effectual that the probation had then closed, for those who had not the same light and privileges are then afforded the opportunity to take their crown. So there's other statements then. We can see that Ellen White makes that I'll bring sort of the last bit of the document has a lot more statements on this here. But this is like the wise version, therefore go into the world and bring God's children here in the other churches and other parts of the world into the kingdom. Although the wise versions can be equated with the 144,000, not all of the wise versions will compose the 144,000, in that many of them will be martyrs at the Sunday law crisis, as the following passage suggests. The five wise versions at the end of the world keep the commandments of God and endure persecution. John was shown these things in holy vision. He saw the company represented by the five wise virgins, their lamps trimmed and burning, and he exclaimed in rapture, "Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus." And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, "Write, blessed are the dead that die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors and their works do follow them." So blessed are they dead which die in the Lord. So we can see there that the five wise are connected with that group of people. So the bride is the church in the application of Christ's object lessons and not the holy city. In Christ's object lessons, we are told that the bridegroom goeth forth to meet his bride and bring her to his home, and that the wise virgins were to lighten the path of the bridegroom's home to the city of God. So in combining and considering these two statements, we can see that the bride is taken to the home of the bridegroom, in which is the city of God. Therefore, the bride and the city of God in this application are differentiated. The bride, therefore, represents a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle, and the wise virgins represent a subsection of that church. So I have this here, as it is in the parable of the 10 virgins, drawn out on a line. So the 10 virgins go forth to meet the bridegroom. Only 5 have spare oil. So that's just like a general application. Adventists expect and preach the second coming of Christ. There is a delay. So that's Christ's coming is longer than expected. Faith is tried. A cry is made at midnight. The bridegroom is coming. So I'm placing out the Sunday law. All the virgins are awakened. The 5 with their oil fill their lamps, and the lamps of the foolish has gone out. So the 5 wise receive the latter rain. And then, realizing their lack, the foolish plead to the wise for oil, but they're told to go and buy. And the foolish virgins take the mark of the beast, which to be able to buy at that time, they have to have that mark. Then the five with oil follow the bridal train into the house, and the door is shut. So that would be the close of human probation. And then the foolish arrive late at the house and plead to be let in, but are refused. So that would be the time of Jacob's trouble and the 7 last plagues. So that's the first section. Any comments or thoughts on that?
Well, there's some good points that you notice there, that especially about the buying after the Sunday law, the foolish go to buy.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. So the next section is the parables fulfillment in Millerite history, as expounded in the Great Controversy. And she says that the coming of Christ, as announced by the first angel's message, was understood to be represented by the coming of the bridegroom. The widespread reformation under the proclamation of his soon coming answered to the going forth of the virgins. So the first angel's message arrived in 1798. She says, Paul covers with his caution the whole of the Christian's dispensation down to the year 1798. It is this side that the message of Christ's second coming is to be proclaimed. It began to be announced by William Miller in 1831. So I'm saying I'll probably put that there. Even though it takes place by 1831 before it's actually being proclaimed, but you know, we would say that 1798 being the time they end, that you have like a process beginning that leads to that proclamation. And then the foolish Millerites, they moved from impulse. Their fear had been excited by the solemn message, but they depended.
What does that mean, impulse? They moved by impulse. I don't get that.
Feelings.
Ah. Thank you.
Thank you, yes. So their fears had been excited by the solemn message, but they depended upon the faith of their brethren, satisfied with the flickering light of good emotions, without a thorough understanding of the truth or genuine work of grace in the heart. They had gone forth to meet the Lord full of hope in the prospect of immediate reward, but they were not prepared for delay and disappointment. And then about the wise Millerites, the latter class had received the grace of God, the regenerating, enlightening power of the Holy Spirit, which renders his word a lamp to the feet and a light to the path. In the fear of God, they had studied the scriptures to learn the truth and had sought for purity of heart and life. These had personal experience and faith in God and in his word, which could not be overthrown by disappointment and delay. And then we have the bridegroom tarrying, 1798 to, well, this is, takes you to, if you go to 1844, then this year occurs at the first day of the first month. The end of the year 1843 had ended. We mark April 19 as the beginning of the tarrying time of the following biblical year. So Ellen White, she writes right that there, when the time passed at which the Lord's first coming was expected in the spring of 1844, those who had looked in faith for his appearing were for a season involved in doubt and uncertainty. So we should be familiar with that history. And then they all slumbered and slept. One class in unconcern and abandonment of their faith, the other class patiently waiting for clearer light should be given. And then we have fanaticism beginning among a minority of Adventists. She says some who had professed to be zealous believers in the message rejected the word of God as the one infallible guide and claiming to be led by the Spirit, gave themselves up to control of their own feelings. So that would be the acting on impulse, impressions and imaginations. There were some who manifested a blind, bigoted zeal, denouncing all who would not sanction their course. Their fanatical ideas and exercises met with no sympathy from the great body of Adventists, yet they served to bring reproach upon the cause of truth. So in rejecting the word of God, their lamps would go out. Therefore, this class with fanatical ideas can be reckoned with the foolish versions. And then the Bible was seemed to explain the delay. We have them passages in Habakkuk and Ezekiel. And then at midnight, a cry was made, behold, the bridegroom cometh. So this is Samuel Snow in Boston, midway between the time when it had been first thought that the 2,300 years would end and the autumn of the same year to which they were afterwards found that they extended, the message was proclaimed in the very words of scripture, behold, the bridegroom cometh. And then we have Samuel Snow's presentation there in Boston. He understands that he was at midnight and Given the Midnight Cry. So that was from John Loughborough's book, The Great Second Advent Movement. And we know that's precisely midway. It was the fifth day of the fourth month, which corresponds to Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 1. And a hundred period, 187 days between the end of 1843 and the 10th day of the seventh month. Then we have the 2,300 years began in the autumn of 457. That was understood by them. They understood the evidence of Old Testament typology. This here just sets out how the 10th day of the seventh month can be seen in 457 BC by taking the midpoint between the first day of the fifth month when Ezra arrived in Jerusalem and the 20th day of the ninth month when the men were gathered to separate from strange wives. So in a sense, the decree that Ezra had been given was being acted upon. So between them two dates, we have the 10th day of the seventh month. And then verse 7, then all the virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. So after his presentation in Boston, Samuel Snow again presented the Midnight Cry in Concord, Massachusetts, early in August 1844. However, it was not until after he had presented the message during the Exeter, New Hampshire camp meeting, which was held between the 12th and 17th of August, that the message took effect with power that Elmite here describes. So he talks about there, the message went like a tidal wave, fanaticism disappeared, and persevering prayer, so forth. And then we have an account of Snow's presentation and its effect. So this was from The Midnight Cry, I think from F.D. Nicol. So I included that, where he talks about Samuel Snow's presentation in Exeter.
Now, Stephen, so, I mean, obviously, with that paper on the timing of the Midnight Cry that I did, so yes. One thing we see is that, and you're probably not going to try to correct that, though, right, dealing with them getting mixed up between Boston and Exeter.
Mm-hmm. I'm just, this is more just for Adventists.
And, yeah.
You know, I don't want to hit them with all that. It's quite a lot of work to wade through. I'm just really identifying getting to the 15th of August.
Yeah.
You know, we're just identifying that. So maybe you can sort of, when they get to another stage, they can understand that in a bit more detail. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, because also like with the two periods of 70 days, that's just a simplification so that they can see the 10th day of the seventh month, because most people aren't going to know how the biblical calendar works. Right? They're not going to know it's 30 and 29 and,
mm-hmm.
yes. and all that. Mm-hmm. You could give a footnote, though, to my papers on academia, when it comes to the Midnight Cry paper.
That's a good idea. Yes, I can do that. That's a good idea. Thank you. Yeah. So a practical application of what is meant by the trimming of the lamps. They studied the word of God with an intensity of interest before unknown. Angels were sent from heaven to arouse those who had become discouraged and prepare them to receive the message. The work did not stand in the wisdom and learning of men, but in the power of God. Not the most talented, but the most humble, devoted. So farmers left their crops, so forth. Those who had formerly led in the cause were amongst those the last to join the movement. So an example of this is William Miller himself, who did not join the movement until early October. Mr. Miller had a year and a half previously called attention to the seventh month as an important one in the Jewish dispensation. But as late as the date of his last letter, September 30, he had discountenanced the positiveness with which some were then regarding it. On the 6th of October, he was first led to favour the expectation which pointed to that month, and thus wrote, if Christ does not come within 20 or 25 days, so kind of interesting there, you mean like a reversal of 25-20, I shall feel twice the disappointment I did in the spring. Publications were slow to accept Snow's message. Several Advent papers came into the view only at a late hour. And this paper, the Advent Herald, was the last to raise its voice in the spread of the cry. For a long time, we were determined to take no part in the movement, either in opposition or in the advocacy of it. It was not until within about 2 weeks of the commencement of the seventh month, which was about the 1st of October, that we were particularly impressed with the progress of the movement, when we had such a view of it that to oppose it or even to remain silent longer seemed to us to be opposing the work of the Holy Spirit. And in entering upon the work with all our souls, we could but exclaim, "What were we that we should resist God?" It seemed to us to have been so independent of human agency that we could but regard it as a fulfillment of the Midnight Cry. So the Midnight Cry empowered the message that Babylon has fallen. The churches in general closed their doors against this message, and a large company of those who received it withdrew from their connection. In the providence of God, this proclamation united with the second angel's message and gave power to that work. So, connecting that to Revelation 14, verse 8. The Midnight Cry in 1844 was typified by the triumphal entry. So Jeff had noted that. So then the foolish said unto the wise, "Give us your oil," so forth. The foolish virgins, many who professed to be looking for Christ and no part in the work of the message, the glory of God which they had witnessed, which the humility, the deep devotion of the waiting ones, and the overwhelming weight of evidence caused them to profess to receive the truth, but they had not been converted. They were not ready for the coming of the Lord. So they have no work in that their message from that come meeting. And then there's parallel passages that relate to the coming of Christ, of coming of the bridegroom to the marriage. That SSL might, she makes this in Great Controversy. She connects Daniel 8:14 to Daniel 7:13, the Son of Man coming to the Ancient of Days, and then the coming of the Lord to his temple, foretold by Malachi 3, verse 1. What the marriage represents. The coming of the bridegroom here brought to view takes place before the marriage. The marriage represents the reception of Christ of his kingdom. So the bride is the holy city. The holy city, the New Jerusalem, which is the capital and representative of the kingdom, is called the bride, the Lamb's wife. Said John to the angel, "Come hither and I will show thee the bride, the Lamb's wife." He carried me away in the spirit, says the prophet, and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. Clearly then, the bride represents the holy city. And then the virgins represents the church. A statement there confirming that. And then where the bridegroom came to and how the virgins went into the marriage. So at the appointed time, the bridegroom came not to the earth as the people expected, but to the Ancient of Days in heaven, to the marriage, the reception of his kingdom. They were not to be present in person at the marriage, for it takes place in heaven, while they are upon the earth. The followers of Christ are to wait for their Lord when he will return from their wedding, but they are to understand his work and to follow him by faith as he goes in before God. It is in this sense that they are said to go into the marriage. So in this application, the marriage between Christ and the Holy City began on October 22nd, 1844. Christ will return from the wedding to receive those who went into the marriage by faith at his second coming to be guests at the marriage supper of the Lamb. The other application where the bride is a church only occurs after the sins of those who compose the church have gone forth to judgment and have been blotted out, and she is without spot or wrinkle. This judgment had only begun to occur in Millerite history, and therefore another application for the bride was involved that related it to the holy city. So there's no way that the bride could have been the church in that application in 1844, as the bride was with she was not without spot or wrinkle. There needed to be a work done, so therefore another application of the bride was required, and that represented the holy city. So those who had all discovered that Christ went into the most holy place on October 22nd, 1844. So there's a statement there. Maybe someone else will just read that. Maybe Theodore, could you read that for me, please?
Okay, so where do you want me to start? Right there, those?
Just in the parable this here.
Okay. In the parable, it was those that had oil in their vessels with their lamps that went into the marriage. Those who, with the knowledge of the truth from the scriptures, had also the spirit and grace of God, and who, in the night of their bitter trial, had patiently waited, searching the Bible for clearer light. These saw the truth concerning the sanctuary in heaven and the Savior's change in ministration, and by faith they followed him in his work in the sanctuary above. And all who, through a testimony of the scriptures, accept the same truths, following Christ by faith as he enters in before God to perform the last work of mediation, and at its close to receive his kingdom, all these are represented as going into the marriage.
Okay, so remember the quotation at the start. This parable has a special application to this time. And like the third angel's message, has been fulfilled and will continue to be present truth to the close of time. So it's still applicable for all those from 1844 to our time, in the sense that this marriage is still going on, and we can still, all those who were faithful went into that marriage as it's taking place by faith in heaven now. So we have their disappointment again. So they were disappointed again. So there's a statement there. So stating that Jesus cannot yet come to the earth. They must yet suffer for Jesus and endure trials, greater trials. They must give up errors and traditions received from men and wholly turn to God and his word. They must be purified, made right, and tried. And those who endure that bitter trial will obtain eternal victory. So they that went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. So this short sentence represents the time from October 22nd, 1844, to the end of Christ's work in the most holy place. She says, when the work of investigation shall be ended, when the cases of those who in all ages have professed to be followers of Christ have been examined and decided, then and not till then, probation will close and the door of mercy will be shut. Thus, in one short sentence, they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. We are carried down through the Saviour's final ministration to the time when the great work for man's salvation shall be completed. While it is true that the door of hope and mercy by which men had for 1800 years found access to God was closed, another door was open, and forgiveness of sins was offered to men through the intercession of Christ in the Most Holy. So we have there. We see that their door being open and shut in Revelation chapter 3, verse 7. The second coming is when Christ returns from the wedding. We have a statement there relates to that. The second coming is when the wise virgins go into the marriage. So there's an element where We go into the marriage by faith, but the second coming is related to that. She says, we are living in the closing scenes of this, closing scenes of these perilous times. The Lord foresaw the unbelief that now prevails, respecting his coming. And again, he has given warning in his word that this event will be expected. The great day will come as a snare on all them that dwell up on the face of the earth. There are but two classes. To one, the apostle gives these encouraging words. You brethren are not in darkness, that day should come upon you as a thief. Some will be ready when the bridegroom comes and will go into the marriage. So I'm not too sure whether maybe that application that's from Six Testimonies. I'm just thinking that could maybe apply to the Christ object lessons application, where the bride is a church. Maybe any thoughts on that there? Because it's, or it could be related. I'm not too sure. I have to think about that. So we have the last three verses of the parable. Ellen White does not refer to or make an application of verses 11 to 13 in the Great Controversy and its fulfillment in the time of the Millerites. In the following quote, however, we do see the effect of Satan upon those who enter by faith into the most holy place with Christ that relates to these verses. So this is from earlier writings, page 54 to 55. This is those who enter into the, after the shut door in 1844, they receive sweet love, joy, and peace. But then there's other, those who just receive, Christ breathes on them and they receive, power, light and power, but no sweet love, joy, and peace. So, but the righteous receive light, power, sweet joy, love, peace. So I think we're familiar with that statement in early writings. In the following statement, we could also apply the foolish versions to those who renounced their faith. The passing of the time in 1844 was followed by a period of great trial to those who held the Advent faith. Their only relief so far as ascertaining their true position was concerned was the light which directed their minds to the sanctuary above. Some renounced their faith in the former reckoning of the prophetic period and ascribed to human or satanic agencies the powerful influence of the Holy Spirit, which attended the Advent movement. So we say those who done that, they are therefore, they would be represented by the foolish versions. From Ellen White's first vision, the foolish versions could also be those who denied the light of the midnight cry behind them. So we know that city, the path going up to the city of God, and some think it's taking too long and they fall in the wicked world below. So there's a disappointment there, could have maybe represented, could be seen those after 1844 following the wicked world below. She says in 1850, a door was still open to honest virgins who were deceived. So she says, I saw yesterday our work was not to shepherds who have rejected the former messages, but to the honest deceived who are led astray. I saw the false shepherds would soon be fed with judgment. Souls are coming out upon the truth all around here. There are those who have not heard the Advent doctrine, and some of them are those who went forth to meet the bridegroom in 1844, but since that time have been deceived by false shepherds until they did not know where they were or what they believed. So there she's having souls coming out upon the truth then in 1850. They were part of that movement in 1844. They have been deceived after that. They were maybe First Day Adventists, or they went to some other section, but here Ellen White's speaking to them in 1850 and they're receiving her message. And so we have here the parable of the 10 virgins on the line based upon its fulfillment in Millerite history. So the 10 virgins go forth to meet the bridegroom. We can reckon that from 1798 to April 18th, 1844. There is a delay, hours pass. The first disappointment, the tarrying time begins. A cry is made at midnight. So beginning 21st of July, Samuel Snow and Empowerment 15th of August. All the virgins are awakened, father lamps. The lamps of the fellowship have gone out. And then they that were ready went in with him. So October 22nd, the shut door to the holy place in heaven. The marriage takes place in heaven. Christ comes to the Ancient of Days and receives the holy city as his bride. Those who had oil enter in by faith with Christ into the most holy place and the marriage. But there's one door shut and the other door is opened. And then we have the shut door at the close of probation. The bridegroom returns from the wedding. And then we have the marriage supper of the Lamb. The saints attend a celebratory feast in heaven. So that's that expounded. Any comments and questions in that section? So
that's very good. Very good. Thank you. Very good.
Thank you. So the parable and history of the first and second angels' messages repeating. So there's a statement there we are familiar with. These are not connected. It says there, we should study the great way marks that point out the times in which we are living. We know that we are in the very, very near the close of this earth's history, and everything of worldly nature should be secondary to the service of God. So studying the great way marks, we should do that because we know that they will be repeating. And we should be able to look at the history of the way great way marks, I'd say, would be Millerite history. Then these point out the times in which we are living. So there's that application of history repeating. And that's why that should be sort of applied. There's another similar statement. So we again return to the following quote. I'm often referred to the parable of the 10 virgins, five of whom were wise and five were foolish. This parable has been and will be fulfilled to the very letter. So we know that that there's a connect to the seven thunders. As another witness to that, she says that the special light given to John was expressed in seven thunders under it. Was a delineation of events which would transpire under the first and second angels' messages. And then the first and second angels' messages were to be proclaimed, but no further light was to be revealed before these messages had done their specific work. And then she says, this is represented by the angel standing on one foot on the sea, proclaiming with a most solemn oath that time should be no longer. So the seven thunders represent the sequence of events that occur under the first and second angels' messages. We are not told what these events specifically are, but we could relate them as occurring from 1798 until October 22nd, 1844, after the first and second angels' messages were proclaimed and done their specific work. Further light could then be revealed. This light relates to the third angel's message, which arrived on October 22nd, 1844. So I have a diagram just trying to set out what Ellen White says there. First angel's message arrived 1798, the second, April 19. And then the third arrives. They've done their specific work. And then further light is revealed in the third angel's message. And then the seven thunders relate to future events, which will be disclosed in their order. So in another sense, that history of the first and second angel's messages will have a future application. which we would relate to 1989 beginning. So the statement that the seven thunders relate to future events, which will be disclosed in their order, implies that these were events future to Ellen White at the time of her writing. Since we know the parable of the 10 virgins has been and will be fulfilled to the very letter, and that the parable covers the history of the first and second angels' messages, it is consistent then that the seven thunders, which covers the same period, will also be fulfilled in a future sense. The only mention of a sealing up of a message in the book of Revelation relates to the seven thunders. This therefore implies that aspects of Millerite history has been sealed up, but there will be a time before the end of the world when it will be unsealed. Revelation 22:11 relates to the close probation. So he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. So the previous verse tells us that this time, that just before this time, there will be an unsealing. It says in verse 10, seal not the sayings of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand. Therefore, that which was sealed up in Millerite history will be unsealed to the last generation of Adventism. Here we have the seven thunders, the first and second angels' messages, then they're sealed. And then the seven thunders are going to be unsealed, and then events disclosed in their order, which takes us up to the close of probation. So the midnight cry was proclaimed under the first and second angels' messages, a message for the whole world. The bridegroom is delayed. In order that all that may have an opportunity to hear the last message of mercy to a fallen world. If all the virgins were wise, this world would have been warned by the time of this writing in 1798. I think that kind of relates to what we had read earlier on, that the Lord would have came and they followed on with the message. We are to show the order and application of the first and second angels' messages. So I'm just sort of going over this quickly. Statements concerning the combining of the three messages.
Stephen?
Yes?
Sorry to interrupt, but if you scroll back up a little, I think you have 18, the year, you said 1798, but you have 1898.
Okay, this is the time of her writing.
Okay, the time of her writing, okay.
Okay, she says, many who have heard the first and second angels' messages thought they would live to see Christ coming in the clouds of heaven. Had all who claimed to believe the truth acted their part as wise virgins, the message would ere this have been proclaimed to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. So it's just sort of relating to that the Lord could have came before 1878. Okay. And then she has these here statements about the messages to be combined. The first and second angels' messages are all united and complete in the third. In 1901, she writes, and the third angel followed them. The first and second angel's messages are of great importance and are followed by the third angel's message. All three should be understood and combined. The warning contained in these messages means much more to the world than the majority of God's people comprehend. We are in the Lord's great day of preparation. And just as a footnote there, I'm relating that that's the 6,000th year of Earth's history. And the Sabbath then would be the 7,000th year, the Sabbath rest, 1,000 years. The combining or uniting of the messages in the above statements are not specific as to when the combining or occurring is occurring, but could apply to the time of writing and relate to the period from October 22nd, 1844 to the close of probation. In the following statement, Ellen White identifies a future event to her time of writing in 1888, when the angel of Revelation 18 descends and empowers the third angel, as being the time when all three messages are combined. She says, God has given The messages of Revelation 14, their place in the line of prophecy, and their work is not to cease till the close of this earth's history. The first and second angels' messages are still truth for this time, and to run parallel with that which follows. The third angel's message proclaims, the third angel proclaims his warning with a loud voice. So after these things, said John, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. So that's Revelation 18 angel. She says, in this illumination, the light of all three messages is combined. So again, the combining of all three messages is here connected. So she sort of says something similar. The angel of Revelation 18 is connected to the repeating of the first, second, and third angel's messages. So it was a statement there relating to that. And the fulfillment of Revelation 18, 1 to 3 is linked to when the great buildings of New York are thrown down. So that we should be familiar with that statement. The second angel unites with the third at the Sunday Law. So that's from the Great Controversy. We should be familiar with that. And then the repeating of the second, the repeating of the first angel's message at the end of the world. So I'm going to now look at Daniel 11, verse 40, and say that the first angel's message is going to be compared to 1798. That France, 1798, the king of the south is France. And then in Russia is going to be the king of the south in 1989. That's going to be overthrown by the papacy, so we should be familiar with that. Lewis F. Weir in the 1950s understood that the papacy would at some time defeat the atheistic USSR. He writes in the context of the 1956 Hungarian uprising, for a number of years, the writer has declared that communism's power would crumble or fall before the rising power of the papacy, as declared by Daniel's last prophecy concerning the king of the north. World events are now coming in line with the interpretation previously presented. While communism is still a force and will no doubt yet reveal great strength and occasional further bloodshed in fighting for its existence, yet recent revelations indicate that someday in the not too distant future, the forces of atheistic communism will be temporarily subdued by the combined forces of Christendom. So we know there that communism that was eventually occurred, and so in considering Ellen White's statements concerning the combining of the three messages, there is the potential for a general application to the combining from 1844 to the close of Revelation, to their combining from that time. She also points out forward to a future time when they will be combined, namely when the angel of Revelation 18 descends, fulfilling verses 1 to 3 of Revelation 18. Which she connects to the throwing down of the great buildings of New York City. So I have here the placing of statements concerning the combining of the messages. So we have here 1798 to 1844. So she says here, the first and second angels' messages are all united and complete in the third. We are now under a proclamation of the third, but all three messages are still to be proclaimed. So it's quite sort of like, you can sort of see it happening in her time. But then she says, concerning when the angel of Revelation 18 descends, the giving of the last and threefold message of warning to the world. In this illumination, the light of all three messages is to be combined. And then she says the first, second, and third angels' messages will need to be repeated. So in a sense, there's a more definite application to when these here messages are combined between this here time when the Revelation 18 descends and when Michael stands up. So now I look at the criteria for Revelation 18 being 1 to 3 being fulfilled. So I repeat that section where she talks about the buildings of New York City being thrown down. She says, when the Lord shall arise to shake terribly the earth, then the words of Revelation 18:1-3 will be fulfilled. Then I have there Revelation 18:1-3 mentioned. And then I go into what the Lord, when does the Lord arise to shake terribly the earth? And then the, so the statement there about from Isaiah, for the day of the Lord of hosts will shall be upon everyone that is proud and lofty. It talks about the loftiness of man. They run into the holes of the rocks, into the caves, when he arises to shake terribly the earth. So this is our, we believe we can connect this to the seven last plagues. Ellen White says, the Lord will arise to shake terribly the earth. We shall see trouble on all sides. Thousands of ships will be hurled in the depths of the sea. Navies will go down. Human lives will be sacrificed by millions. Fires will break out unexpectedly, and no human effort will be able to quench them. The palaces of the earth will be swept away in the fury of flames. Disasters by rail will become more and more frequent. Confusion, collision, and death without a moment's warning will occur on the great lines of travel. The end is near. Probation is closing. Or let us seek God while he may be found. So that it may be what we may be heading the day of the Lord's anger. So Revelation 18:1-3, she's connecting it to the day of the Lord in this year's statement, and this time of the seven last plagues. There's another statement where she says, the day of the Lord, the God will plague the wicked inhabitants of the earth. Earth's crust will be broken up, so forth. Similar to the deluge, after the shut door, Noah's flood. Therefore, the day of the Lord begins after the close of probation, and it is the time of the seven last plagues, when the Lord arises to shake terribly the earth. When the Lord arises equates to when Michael stands up. At that time, so we read that. So the quote of July 5, 1906, about the New York great buildings, then directs us to Revelation 18:1-3 as being fulfilled. But other quotes provide a more expansive understanding relating to its fulfillment. So Revelation 18:1-3, there's this here statement from Great Controversy, pages 389, where Ellen White will then talk about the Sunday law being the time of the fulfillment of Revelation 1-3. So in considering these words, although Revelation 14:1-8 is applied to 1844, it was but a partial fulfillment and is perfectly fulfilled when Babylon's fall will be complete and all nations will have drunken of her wine that is brought in view in the following passage. Sorry, I just want to skip this because I think this is from a Great Controversy as well, where we have Babylon fallen. She talks about a spurious one of the commandments being not given. I'm maybe getting mixed up in the passage. I'm just trying to go on here quickly. there's a lot of information here, by the way. I know I'm just trying to give a brief overview. So therefore, Revelation 18:1-3 is fulfilled at the close of probation. It can also be represented as occurring over a period of time prior to that close, when the world is warned not to take the mark of the beast. There is a statement where she says, the substitution of the laws of man for the law of God, the exaltation by merely human authority of Sunday in the place of the Bible Sabbath, is the last act in the drama. When the substitution becomes universal, God will reveal himself. He will arise in majesty to shake terribly the earth. We'll have another diagram here about fulfillment of Revelation 18:1-3, just with where she is placing it. She initially says, she places it here at the close of probation, when the Lord shall arise to shake terribly the earth. But then she says it's like a period of time as well, where there's a message come out of her, my people. Another angel comes down. So that's Revelation. And that's come out of Babylon, as great as fallen has fallen. And then we have the seven last plagues. The Lord shall arise to shake terribly the earth, the day of the Lord, from the closer equation to the second advent of Christ. So that's that, a summary there of that section. Okay, just a quick prayer again. Dear Heavenly Father, we give thanks thus far for this study, your guidance in it. I pray that your Holy Spirit continue to be with us in just the remaining time to look at this year study. In Jesus' name, amen. So just some volunteer to read this paragraph in the next section. So this is called 9/11 and the prophecy of the throwing down of the great buildings of New York City. Someone would like to volunteer to read that for me, please.
Yeah, I can read that. So section 5, 9/11 and the prophecy of the throwing down of the great buildings of New York City. We can sense something of the terrible calamities that will come upon the earth when the Lord arises to shake terribly the earth, and that the great buildings of New York City will be included in that destruction. But not only the great buildings, but many lesser buildings of that city, and not only in New York, but throughout the earth. We have seen that the fulfillment of Revelation 18, 1 to 3, covers a period of time leading to the close of probation and can be traced back at least as far to the time when Sunday legislation begins. But is there scope that it could be traced back even further? To not consider the events of September 11th, 2001, as to relating to what Ellen White saw in regards to the great buildings of New York City being thrown down, there is a risk that we could be like the Jews of Christ's day, who disregarded the star that brought from the that brought the Magi from the East, knowing the place where the promised seed would be born. Quote, they would not even go to Bethlehem to see whether these things were so, and they led the people to regard the interest in Jesus as a fanatical excitement. End of quote. September 11th, 2001 was an event that startled and changed the world. It led many for a time to search their Bibles, but there was no discernible Sunday law or a mighty cry denouncing the sins of Babylon soon thereafter. However, we should at least investigate the potential for it relating to Ellen White's vision, lest we neglect to see a sign that God has provided, which could reveal another way of interpreting the event and its significance in the line of prophecy.
That's great, thank you.
August? Okay.
Just keep reading. Keep going.
Okay. August 11th, 1840, in understanding that the parable has been and will be fulfilled, we should then consider if there is anything in the parable's initial fulfillment in Millerite history that correlates with the events of September 11th, 2001. After the first angel's message arrived in 1798, that message received an impetus when the world's main Islamic power at that time placed itself under the protection of four Christian nations. That event resulted in the restraining of a more radical element of Islam that then was developing in Egypt. Of this event, Ellen White thus writes.
Okay,
in the year 1840. Okay.
Yeah, so we should be familiar with that from the Great Controversy, the fulfillment of the 381 years of 15 days of Josiah Litch's prophecy. And then that provided an impetus to Miller's work. And then I have here page 611 of the Great Controversy. The angel who unites in the proclamation of the third angel's message is to lighten the whole earth with his glory. A work of worldwide extent and unwonted power is here foretold. The Advent movement of 1840 to 1844 was a glorious manifestation of the power of God. So we know that there, this here is a period of 1,533 days that then began after that fulfillment of prophecy concerning Islam on August 11th, 1840. So just identifying that sort of period of, so there you have a glorious manifestation of the power of God. I'm thinking there, you have this period has been paralleled with the angel who unites in the proclamation of the third angel's message, which is to lighten the whole earth with his glory. So this is a reference to the angel of Revelation 18:1-3. If the empowerment of the first angel's message resulted from a restraint of Islam, that could not that which it is paralleled also be expected? So the angel coming down in Revelation chapter 10 parallels the angel coming down in Revelation chapter 18. So the Adventists have some Adventist pioneers connecting out there. We have the angel, mighty angel, 1 foot in the sea, 1 foot in the land. And then you have the seven thunders being uttered. So the Adventist pioneers, they said, John saw a mighty angel descend to the earth, having in his hand a little book open, not closed, not sealed, but open. It was at the close of the Second Woe in 1840 that this angel with the open book of Daniel set 1 foot on the land and 1 foot on the sea. So that was by Stephen Haskell, another one by J.N. Andrews. He also connects that event as well. And then another one by A.T. Jones. We have also Revelation 10, where John enacts the experience of the Millerites. So that's, he takes a little book and it's sweet in his mouth and bitter in his stomach. So we're describing that sweetness beginning in 1840 and the bitterness there in 1844. So in paralleling 1989 to 1798, we should expect an event afterwards that parallels the restraint of Islam on August 11th, 1840, connected with an angel coming down. Soon after September 11th, 2001, we saw nominal Christian nations restrain Islamic powers with the invasion of Afghanistan and Iraq in 2003. We have the words of Ellen White that relate the angel of Revelation 18 being fulfilled, being connected to when the great buildings of New York are thrown down. However, Revelation 18 relates to a repeat of the second angel rather than the first angel. We've seen that the 1840 is connected with the first angel rather than the second. So for September 11th, 2001, to be of prophetic consequence, we would have to understand that the event combines the empowering of the first angel's message with the arrival of the second. In this illumination, the light of all three messages is combined. So the Sunday Law Decree is still future as of the date of writing this document in October 22, 1844, but could September 11, 2001 be marking its beginning in a progressive sense? For the Sunday Law to be enacted, there must be a violation of the United States Constitution, specifically the First Amendment. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech of the press or of the press or of the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. The events of September 11th provided the government the justification to introduce the Patriot Act, which violates the Constitution in several ways. So we have there the Fourth Amendment and the First Amendment specifically. who says that the government cannot conduct a search without obtaining a warrant and showing the probable cause to believe that the person has committed or will commit a crime. So elements there. So investigations of American citizens in part for exercising their freedom of speech. So there's some issues there with that. So as further calamities occur, then further grounds for restrictions of liberty will be enacted. These restrictions will culminate with the Sunday Law Decree and the enforcement of the Mark of the Beast. Seventh-day Adventists have long expected this event and saw signs of its approach with the vaccine mandates and the medical martial law type lockdowns that were associated with the COVID-19 pandemic. But how many are heeding the Sacred Council to consider events in the light that Millerite history will be repeated? Millerite history is a template that will help guide our understanding of the procession of events as we approach the end of all things. So I've made a sort of a footnote there concerning Revelation 18 being fulfilled, being connected to the great buildings of New York City being thrown down. The footnote says, the Twin Towers were the highest buildings in the city at that time and can be aptly described as great buildings. At the time of the publishment of the prophecy in 1906, the greatest building at that time in New York was the Park Row building, being 391 feet or 119 meters. The restraining of Islam occurred after a prophecy of 391 years, and 119 could be seen to symbolize the 11th of September. So that you can get that information on Wikipedia on 15 Park Row.
Nice pick up there, Stephen.
Okay, thank you. So the first angel message. So this is something about the repeat. I'm actually going to go into that buildings a bit more here. I have some more diagrams to talk about that. So the first angel arrives, 1798. Then we have this here, first angel empowered. Angel of Revelation 10 descends. And Islam is restrained on 11th of August, 1840. And then you have that sweetness. And then that's a day for a year prophetic interpretation is confirmed without their 391-year prophecy. And so I have here in question marks, is this here like the first angel arrives, 1989, and then September 11th, 2001, first angel empowered, Revelation of 18 descends, and then the second angel arrives and Islam restrained again. And we have here the repeating of Millerite history confirmed, question mark. So I'm not being sort of forcing, saying yes, it's definitely. I'm just sort of saying it's considered as a possibility. So when Ellen White says, I looked up at the great buildings going up there story after story. So she says that this was wrote in August the 9th, 1903. Now it was published in Review and Herald 5th of July, 1906. But she says, if you look at that document in the 1906, she says she wrote it in 1903 on the 9th of August. So that was 42 years after, or 42 years before Hiroshima, not Nagasaki. That was the one I'm thinking of, sorry. So just some interesting information concerning these two buildings. So the Park Row building here is 119 meters and 391 feet. So as I said, connects with that there 391 year prophecy. And you have a symbol there for 9/11. So that was the greatest building at the time of her writing. And then the next building that was superseded that was completed in 1908. And that was 187 meters, which was 613 feet. So the Jews have calculated 613 commandments in the 187 chapters of the Torah. So there's an interesting sort of maybe connection there. The tallest building ever destroyed in the world until the attacks of September 11th brought down the Twin Towers of the World Trade Center was this here building here, and this is called the Singer Building. So you heard the Singer sewing machines. So that was the next greatest building in New York after her time of writing. This one here was completed in 1899, and this one was completed in 1908. Another statement from Wikipedia, it says, between 1890 and 1908, the number of buildings in Lower Manhattan above 10 stories increased from 6 to 538. So this is what I'm thinking, that when Elma is making that statement, she's watching the great buildings of New York going up story by story. Buildings, so there's these here, just loads of buildings basically going up around at their time. So this is probably what she's witnessing. And she's just calling all them buildings going above 10 stories as being great buildings. But these would be the greatest. That would be the greatest of her time of writing, and that would be the next one. So you have the symbol there of July 18, the next one. And this one here, maybe you could even connect with November 9th as well. And 538 is the date when the 1260 began. And you could also connect it to the fall of Babylon. So the building that replaced the buildings destroyed at the time of the third row, beginning of the third row. So this here wouldn't be in the actual document that you would send to Adventists. This is just for us really to look at. So this here new building that replaced, called the One World Trade Center, that replaced the Twin Towers, is 541 meters or 1776 feet. So that was by design. They wanted to equate to the number, the date that the USA was founded. So it's in this year, 541 meters then connects to the First and Second Wars. So from 1299 to 1844 is 541 years. And then if you want to put in there 1776, it was for 327 years from 1449. To me, that was maybe like a hint there towards that we normally connect March 27th or 273 to be in the Levites. We get that from numbers four, but it's like the same numbers, but sort of reversed a wee bit or mixed up. So we're familiar with, I think, the last presentation about was a presentation from Order to Chaos, Order Out of Chaos, I think it was called. I brought up this here diagram where we have 300 years from when the kingdom divided until Manasseh was taken captive. And this paralleled the time when Joseph was 30 years old. So we have here a multiplication of 10 of the years here being seen here. There was then 70 years to the Babylonian captivity, which paralleled the 7 years of plenty. And then there were 7 years again of famine. Down here, 7 years of famine. And that parallels the 7 years of captivity that ended with Cyrus being enthroned. And this year period can be divided up into 20 years and 50 years by the siege of Jerusalem. And this year can be divided, 7 years can be divided between 2 years and 5 years, when Joseph is joined again by Jacob. And we note that at the age of Jacob, he was 130 years old at that their time. And we can note 130 years from that their time when Jerusalem is being besieged to Artaxerxes' decree in 457 BC. So just a point I noticed, if we continue on with the age of Joseph, at the end of when the famine ends, the 7 years of famine, Jacob then continued to live another 12 years, and he died age 147. Now, if you go multiply up with 10 and go 120 years from when Cyrus was enthroned, it takes you to 417 BC. So we have there the same numbers of, as the age of Jacob there, sort of mixed up. But what this here connects is also to the structure of the One World Trade Center. It's actually 417 meters just from the base to the top of the building before you get to the antenna. And then when, after Jacob died, Joseph lived to 110, which was the number of stories of the Twin Towers that were destroyed previously. But he lives another further 54 years. So he's 56 when Jacob dies and lives another 54 years. Now, if we go another 540 years, it takes us to the year 124 AD. Now, to do that math, it's crossing the BC AD mark. So the math would be minus 417 plus 541 will give you 124. So 54, so you're taking these 540 years and just adding an extra one for the math. And that, again, will give you the height of the whole building to the top of the antenna. And 124 would take you to 124 AD. And that would be the height of the antenna, the 124 meters.
Yeah, you could just do an inclusive count, though, of the years.
You could do that as well, yeah. Yes. The protective base at the bottom of it. So the designers had concern that there could be some truck taken to the foot of the building and another bomb going off. So what they did, they had this here concrete protective base, and they made it 187 feet by 200 feet wide. So I think it's 187 feet tall. So they have there another symbol of July 18. Another thing I did was I took that even further from that 124 AD. So when Joseph dies, aged 110, it's 144 years to the Exodus. And so 100 multiplied by 10, 1440 years takes us to the year 1464 AD. I haven't noticed any event. I'm just sort of, that's where it comes to. I haven't really looked in too much details of what happened. Is there anything there that could parallel me with the Exodus or anything? Then you have 40 years wandering in the wilderness, which, so the 400 years then would take you to 1964. So that would parallel the crossing of the Jordan. And then they were 6 years taking the land to when Caleb says he was 85 years when he takes Hebron. So you can, through his age here, you can identify a 6 year period to when, and then Shiloh is then, the tabernacle is then set up in Shiloh. And Elmite makes a statement that it's going to be there for 300 years. But anyway, these 6 years would then become 60 years. And that would take us to the year 2024 AD. So tomorrow that would be a year away. Now, I have noted there the US elections due, just so when it came to mind, 2024, that's just kind of came to mind that that's something that's due to occur at that year time. So this is a whole period of 300 years. And then from the dividing of the kingdom to the US elections in 2024, if they do happen, it's going to be 3,000 years. Just some more. There's some that didn't happen. Okay. I maybe didn't put it in.
Stephen? Stephen? What happened in 1964? What was the... what marks the 1964?
Okay, I haven't noted anything, but I'm just sort of saying, have observed that when Abraham went from Haran into the Promised Land, it was in 1963 BC.
Okay.
You also had the silver standard being done away with in 1964 in the U.S.
Oops. Right, okay.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting. Okay.
So the midway point then would be 1 AD, be the midway point. So the BCAD date would be the midway point between 1964. So here we have like the crossing of the Jordan. So this is the Israelites going into Canaan. And 1 AD then would be the midpoint between Abraham, or Abram at the time, in 1963 BC, going into the Canaan. 124 AD was the date when this here BCAD date was instituted. So that sort of connects to that there, 180 as well. So that's just my observation so far. I just sort of, this is what I do when you expand it further. I don't know if, I haven't really thought much. I just thought I would do it, show that there's something quite maybe just interesting applying to our time potentially.
They're not arbitrary numbers, Stephen. You've come up with these things through this thought process and now are demonstrating it with these waymarks basically. And I can see where you're going with that. I look forward to being able to go over this documentation personally.
Okay. So
just a question. So you're saying about 124. What were you saying about 124 AD?
So yeah, 124 AD was the date when it became popular then to have 1 AD as being the BCAD date being popular.
Okay, I thought that was in 525.
According to Wikipedia, it's became accepted in one, or popular anyway, in 124.
Okay, but I thought it was Dionysius Exiguus, however you say his name, who enumerated this in his Easter table. And that's the first time that was ever done.
Okay.
So there must be something else that you're marking 124.
So I did do it.
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. I just,
he's basing this on Wikipedia.
I know, but I think he just misread something. I think there's something about. There's something about 124, but I don't think it's when they came up with the ADBC system, because that was 525.
I'm just going with what Wikipedia brought up.
Yeah, I know, but I'm saying you might have misread something.
Uh-huh.
Because I think 124 has something to do with something, but not specifically that. So I'm not sure.
Okay, so what I'll do is I have this here. Find it. I thought I had added it to the diagram, but
okay. Anyway, I know it wasn't created that early.
Mm-hmm.
So that's much, much later.
Okay. That's what it says. When Anno. Not okay. This is the diagram. That's going to behave.
Okay, yeah, I'll look that up and see if I can find it.
Yeah, when Anno Domini calendar era became the prevalent method in Europe for naming years, 124 AD. So that's what it says there. Now I have 121 AD there, and 1963 and the 1963 there. So Abraham leaves Haran, enters Canaan. Israelites enter Canaan after leaving Egypt. So whether that's
just, Wikipedia just, saying it's 525.
Okay.
So I'm not sure.
So would that be says it became prevalent method then, but maybe.
That just might just be a mistake. Is that in an article called 124 AD?
It's just a Wikipedia.
But is it article? Is the article 124 AD in Wikipedia?
Yes, it is, yes. So you say it's 525?
That's what Wikipedia says. They say 525.
Right, okay. Thank you for that.
Well, that's not the first time that I've heard two different references from Wikipedia.
Okay, so another diagram from that.
Stephen, I just did a search, and the Civil Rights Act was 1964. So that could parallel for you.
Sorry, what happened in 1964?
The Civil Rights Act.
All right, okay. Yeah. Well, maybe we can sort of any comments or ads, you know, we can maybe sort of these this further light can be sort of gleaned from that there if there is anything significant in 1964 that would mark the exodus in some way. I'm not too sure whether that would or not. But here we're finding the tabernacle being set up in Shiloh, that you have is like a midpoint between these here. You got 300 years would it exist, and then 300 years to the birth of Joseph. And Jacob was it was 6 years after Joseph was born when Jacob returned to Canaan. And then it was 6 years previously when the Israelites entered Canaan. So you have that sort of like a mirror aspect with them 300 years. You had 7 years of Rachel serving then previous to that. And there's an Elvite statement. She says, for 7 months, the ark remained in Philistia. During all this time, the Israelites made no effort for its recovery. So you have 7 months mentioned there, and then you could have 7 years previous to that before.
Just Stephen, on the, I noticed like every one of those dates ended with 87 up above. A little higher.
All right. Okay.
Where
yes.
Came from.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
One of those dates on the top line have 80.
Just I had mentioned there. So that's the diagram I was thinking of there. I put it in the wrong place. But the Ark in Philistia 7 months then. If we're going to continue on with that idea beyond this year, 2024, and if we are going to mark the US elections due in 2024 and then go 7 months from, well, I suppose that would be in the wrong place. We'd have to go 300 years, actually, so maybe forget about that. But I had the idea of going 7 months from there, but it's actually... It would be them 7 months would actually go beyond them 300 years. So maybe maybe it doesn't apply. But no, in the same way, them 7 months would be 70 months. So I had this year idea from the election. It's June 5th of November 2024. If you go 70 months, it takes you to the 5th of September 2030. And then if you go 65 months, it takes you to the first day of the first month, which would be April 5th, 2030. So maybe that wouldn't be the application for this year time, because I made a mistake there, a wrong assumption. But maybe 65 months there could be interesting from that election to the first day of the first month in 2030. I'm not sure. Just had that. Maybe it doesn't apply. Maybe just scrap that whole idea whatsoever.
Yeah. So not everybody knows that the first day of the first month in 2030 is exactly 2,300 months from the first day of the first month in 1844. Mm-hmm. And also it's 187 prophetic years and 20 prophetic months. Mm-hmm. So that connects to our symbols. Mm-hmm. And it also connects to the structure that Colin put together.
Okay, so maybe you could think upon that and see, tie it in. Just another observation, from when the ark is moved from Shiloh, you have at 210 days. 7 months. But if you make out 210 years, it takes you to the dividing of the kingdom, which begins at 300 years, which the life of Joseph was paralleled by. So this is like a 210 years, like a midpoint. And at the end of 300 years, you have Manasseh being taken captive, begins at 2520. And I've identified there the midnight cry on the first day of the fifth month in 1844. Now, these here, 300 years previously to when the tabernacle was set up in Shiloh, if you go back 7 years, it takes you to the first day of the fifth month in 1494 BC when Aaron died. So I have there approximate 2520 days. I said years, maybe they are, sorry. 2520 days, seven years. So we are not sure exactly. So this first day of the first month would be around August time in that year. So I'm not too sure. We don't have an exact date in the when the tabernacle was set up in Shiloh. So I'm just saying approximate. It's about 7 years. It wouldn't, might be. As a symbol, it works. So you have that sort of diagram. And if you multiply 210 by the 120 years that preceded, this here dividing of the kingdom with the reigns of Saul, David, and Solomon, you get the number, you have the 25,200. Get 2520 if you take off another zero. And just another observation concerning 9/11, a wee bit more. I'm just throwing it in. Notice from Isaac when he is mocked by Ishmael, it was 1933 BC. And you can identify here that Ishmael, he was like the father of Islam. He's considered like a father of with Abraham. And and since Ishmael here was restrained, he was sort of sent away in some way. So, and then you have that prophecy beginning of 400 years that you find in Genesis 15, verse 13, that there'll be the Abraham's children will be afflicted for 400 years, and then that nation will be judged, and they'll come out with great spoil at the end of that. So that's 1533 BC when the Exodus occurs. And 400 years in prophetic days is 144,000. So you just multiply it by 360. And if you go to the restraint of Islam in August 11th, 1840, we have notified previously the 1533 days it takes you to the investigative judgment in October 22nd, 1844. But it's also exactly 1933 months to the restraint of Islam we can mark on September 11th, 2001. And I was looking for another way. Can we tie in this year 400 with this year scenario? Because we have 1933, we have 1533. If we go back 400 years from 1840, it just takes us to the year 1440. So you have there a symbol of 144,000 there, just in that the 1440 AD. And we can just then 400 years, 144,000 again, prophetic days. You have an angel descending in each account, potentially, you know, with this here Revelation 18 angel, Revelation 14 verses 9 to 11. And Revelation 10 there as well. So I've gone on quite a bit. I'm just thinking time-wise, how are we for time?
You're good. You can keep going.
Because this is pretty long.
If you want to. I mean, if you want to stop, you can. I mean, it's up to you. Daniel's not going to come on here until 3 o'clock.
Right, okay. What time is it there, your time?
Our time right now is 1:08. So we got 2 hours before Daniel starts.
Right, okay. I'll try to move more swiftly on. So with further consideration of the Great Controversy, 6:11, the angel of Revelation 18 is also compared to Pentecost. So we know that there from Rilmite, she does compares it to Pentecost. And we notice there that preceding Pentecost, there was a sprinkling that preceded that when Christ resurrected. There he went to the disciples that evening and he said, "Receive ye the Holy Spirit." This is in the upper room when they were hiding from the Jews. And you had the people from the Emmaus return and Christ appears in their midst. So we have that idea. We're familiar with that. There's a statement there concerning the time of the separation of the wheat and tares, where this here latter rain falls when the church is purified, when the wheat and tares have been separated. There's a statement where Ellen White says that. But then there's another statement where she says that it seems to be like the wheat and tares are together, and that that maybe that the latter rain may be falling in hearts all around us, but we should not be able to discern or receive it. So the idea there is, this is a different type of latter rain. This is a sprinkling when the church is together. And this is a latter rain here. She's talking about full outpouring when the wheat and tares have been separated. So we know that occurs at the Sunday law. So I'm just identifying, putting up a scenario for the Revelation 18 angel coming in a slighter form initially, like in measure, and then before the full outpouring. We have a parallel tarrying time. So we have there in 1844, after the first disappointment, a tarrying time before you. So in a sense there, you have that angel come down of the second angel. And then there's their tarrying time. And then you have like the full outpouring at the midnight cry. So can we sort of see a similar scenario identifying a potential tarrying time, September 11th, 2001. And then I've gone into Revelation 7, where you have these here four angels about to let loose, and then an angel intervenes and says, "Hold, hold, hold, till the 144,000 are sealed." Not in them words, but you sort of get that idea. And then, so in a sense there, you have like a tarring of the full, these here winds, being that's the sort of idea that you have like a something, hold, there's like a hold on here, we're going to tarry until God's people are sealed. And then I've sort of talked about the four winds are being paralleled with the seven last plagues. But however, well, we can also see a potential application with the four winds relating to comparing them to Revelation chapter 9, verse 4, and connecting them to Islam. We have sort of similar language here. In Revelation 7, verse 3, God's heard not the earth, nor the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. And then verse 4 of chapter 9, and it was commanded then that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God on their foreheads. So sort of tying in Islam with this here sealing of 144,000. And we have Abu Bakr's decree has sort of like similar language there. Oops, sorry. You have four angels being mentioned in Revelation 9:15. We see that the four angels were associated with being loosed at the beginning of the sixth trumpet. And the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour, a day, and a month, and a year to slay a third part of the men. This period was understood to be by the pioneers to be the second woe, and equate to 381 years and 15 days. That was ended on 11th of August, 1840. Therefore, these four angels would have been restrained on that date. This, therefore, provides a further witness that the four angels of Revelation 7, verse 1, who are holding the four winds, that an aspect of Islam would be involved in their restraint when they were about to loosen the winds. Ellen White expands that. There's a word, she mentions the word, the four winds, about loosening. Ties in Revelation 9. And then we have a section here about the three wolves. So the wolves are connected to the last three trumpets, of the last three of the seven trumpets. So we have there a quote there from Revelation chapter 11, where it talks about to the inhabitants of the earth by reason of the other voices of the trumpets of the three angels which are yet to sound. So the first and second woes of the fifth and sixth trumpets were aspects of Islam as a judgment against Rome. It would then be logical to assume that Islam would also be seen as a factor of the third woe. So I have here some quotes from Stephen Haskell, from A.T. Jones, and a few others. You can read them in your own time. Also concerning the third woe. I'll just read Haskell's, what his logic was. It says, the second woe is past. Behold, the third woe cometh quickly. The little period between 1840 and 1844, during which the Revelation 10 verses 1 to 11 was delivered, was the time between the close of the sixth trumpet and the sounding of the seventh. So he has the sixth trumpet end on August 11th, 1840. So that's basically covering the same time period as the second woe. He makes a statement where he, this one or where I maybe don't see it there. Or something else he had wrote. I may have left it out, haven't put it in. Oh, maybe it's here. Yeah, this is in 1844, the third woe began. It extends into eternity, covering all the corruption of the last days, the anger or distress amongst the nations, which was one sign of the second advent as given by the Savior. So during the sounding of the seventh trumpet, the seven plagues were poured out. And then he connects that this period continues over 1,000 years following the second coming of Christ and ends when Satan and all the wicked are reduced to ashes. And James White agrees with his view that the third woe, he's basically from 1844 to the end of 1,000 years, covers the period of the seventh trumpet and the third woe. This is Haskell's understanding. James White seems to agree. Eurasmith and A.T. Jones, they also place the third woe beginning in 1844 and ending. I don't really specify when they what ends. Certainly, the second coming of Christ, I think, anyway. J.N. Andrews is a slightly different idea. He identifies a space between the second and third woes and imagines a similar space between the sixth and seventh trumpet. So that would be quite similar to Haskell, Jones, and Smith. They're not identifying what William Floyd did. His visions, they're not recognizing his visions in 1842 when he says the seventh angel has not done sounding. So I have that mentioned there. So they don't seem to have that seventh trumpet continue on through 1844. They're all ending it in 1840. But Haskell has Andrews has a slight difference where he places the third woe as a future event. He says the seven plagues which fill up the wrath of God constitute the third woe. However, in a different understanding to Haskell's and Jones, he sees that the third woe as distinct to the seventh trumpet. So Haskell and Jones basically said the seventh trumpet and the third woe is the same thing. but he's sort of seeing it something different. He says that the seventh trumpet is the closing work of Christ's priesthood. The closing work of Christ's priesthood is in the second apartment of the heavenly sanctuary. This is the opening and under the sounding of the seventh trumpet, Revelation 11, verse 19. These quotes would seem to place the seventh trumpet as beginning in 1844 and the third woe to beginning after the close of probation.
Yeah, so Stephen, we had gone through this, I don't know if you remember, when we were doing examining the foundation.
Okay.
And so, you know, what you're presenting here is there's these differences regarding when the sixth trumpet ended, when the, did it end in connection with the second woe ending? And I think, you know, we concluded that the sixth trumpet continued to sound until October 22nd, 1844. Mm-hmm. And part of that was based upon the vision of, I can't think of his name offhand.
William Foy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then I think it's important to, like, how Andrews understands it, to see the, at least that the woes and the trumpets, even though they parallel each other, they're not identical. And so definitely, I think if you look at the early pioneers, they wouldn't put the third woe as beginning with the sounding of the seventh trumpet on October 22nd, 1844. But the later people do, right? They just kind of put the two together. But I don't find it supported in the spirit of prophecy.
Mm-hmm. No. Yeah,
so
yeah. We don't really have anything like concerning Islam, really, as an afflicting element of happening at that there time upon Rome. So, but we do identify that the seventh trumpet began then. So this is just Haskell's understanding. So he agrees like the first woe beginning the 27th of July, 1299, and then the second woe ending on August 11th. But he then basically lines up the trumpet with the second woe. And then the third woe of the seventh trumpet, and extending it to the destruction of the wicked. Now, J.N. Andrews is slightly different. He has the seventh trumpet again here, but he wouldn't begin the third woe until time of the last plagues. That would be his understanding. So I'm not too familiar with the earlier ones that you mentioned there. It could maybe be good to consider how they saw it as well. William Miller, he initially was looking what was he doing? He was something totally different. I think the second woe, and I think before Josiah Litch anyway, he had a totally different idea of what the second woe was.
Yeah, well, they had this because they were caught up with trying to deal with what was happening with Islam in their time. But also they had a misunderstanding or wrong understanding of Daniel 11, verse 40 to 45. That is, they had the view that you later see with Uriah Smith, where France is this other power, right? So they had the king of the north being the Ottoman Empire and the king of the south being Egypt, and France involved, just like Uriah Smith. So they had these misunderstandings and wrong ideas about what was happening in their time. And that sort of parallels what's happening in our time. So it's a little bit more complex on how they were seeing these woes.
Yeah, I remember, I think Germany comes to mind. I think something to do with Germany. I think William Miller was looking at or something. This is the way, like 1833, you know. So
yeah, he had some different views than at initially, and then they continued to study and they developed. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's not like they were completely united on their understanding of some of these things, but they did see, you know, that originally that the plagues had to occur before the second coming, right?
Mm-hmm.
But as they got closer to 1844, they set aside their understanding of the plagues. And so it's kind of interesting how they did that, because we did that as well with our understanding of things when it came to July 18th. Things that were supposed to happen before July 18th didn't, but we still focused on July 18th. So,
Okay, thanks. So just going back to Foy. So his first vision was on the 18th of January, 1842. And he says the sixth angel has not yet done sounding. And this was 525 days after August 11th, 1840, when they had considered the sixth angel finishing sounding. And it was going to be another 144 weeks until the seventh angel did finish sounding, which is 252 times 4 days, or 1,008 days, you could say. So this year period is 1,533 days, which can it multiplies seven times three times 73. You can do that. And this going to our 777 days, we have from November 9th to July 18th, 252 days, and then 525 days to December 25th, 2021. And that calculation can be done by 3 times 7 times 37. If you want to have a similar connection there with these 777 days to the 1,533, you can add up. And then the way it's sort of divided here, you can have the 252 with 525 there and get the 777, or add the 525 here with the 1,008 and get 1,533. And then I made another application for another pattern from 11th of August 1840. It's 525 days to when Foy had that vision. So that was 525 days before a prediction of Islam. And then it was 525 days after that prediction of Islam that Colin Joseph done that presentation on the 25th of December, 2021. And says the sixth king, he made this triumph, and the other is not yet come, was Biden. So you have that there, the sixth angel is not yet. So you have that not yet and the sixth there connected with that there scenario. So just something I was observing with connecting.
Nice observation.
With William Foy. So I have here something about the three woes, maybe connecting it to the three jihads. There's a movie that came out, or a documentary in 2008 called The Third Jihad. And what it did was parallel the first jihad to basically be in the time of the fifth trumpet, which also contains the first woe, and then the time of the second jihad was comparable to the second woe and the sixth trumpet. And the man's application was that we are now in the time of the third jihad. And to me, I would be connecting that then to the third woe. And so that was, so I'll write a wee bit about that there. And so.
Now, there's also a book written by John Whitcomb. He's an Adventist pastor, which I can't remember the title of it. I think it's something like that. But the Jerusalem Caliphate, it's called, and the Third Jihad. And so that's John C. Whitcomb, W-I-T-C-O-M-B-E. I'm just going to put the link to this here in... I can't do that unless I open this up. I'll put the link to it. And the thing that's interesting, I mean, I know the guy personally, he wrote this book as well. So there's other people who understand a little bit about what happened with 9/11, even if they don't have the understanding we do.
Okay, thank you. So the documentary does not specify specifically identify 9/11 as the beginning of the third jihad, but it was very much characterized as a major event connected to it. With the insights that indicate 9/11 as a prophetic event that parallels the end of the Second War, it is not unreasonable to consider it as the beginning of the third woe of the seventh trumpet. So this would be my understanding of the three woes in connection with the last three trumpets. So the seventh trumpet beginning October 22nd, 1844, and then the third woe, 11th September. So that there, the third woe was passed, and the second woe was passed, and the third cometh quickly. So that would be 1933 months exactly, paralleling the time when the sense Ishmael was restrained in the year 19, well, maybe not in a parallel, but sort of typified by Ishmael being restrained in 1933 BC. So we have the horse symbology in the 1843 and 1850 charts connected with Islam. We have the locusts there in Revelation 9, basically covering the same territory as Islamic countries, the desert locusts, Ishmael being a wild ass of a man. So relevant imagery from Isaiah chapter 27, talking about these verses seem to bear relation to the restraining of the four winds, coupled with the beginning of the sprinkling of the latter rain and the sealing of God's people, with imagery that can be associated with Islam. So you have there, he shall cause them that come out of Jacob to take root. Israel shall blossom and bud and fill the face of the world with fruit. So that's symbolizing the latter rain, when things blossom and bud. And in measure, when it shoot forth, so a sprinkling of the latter rain, when it shoot forth, they will debate with it. He stayeth his rough wind in the day of the east wind. So you have like a streaming of the winds, and the east wind is Islam. And by this shall the iniquity of Jacob be purged. And this is all the fruit to take away his sin. So this is the beginning of the sealing of the 144,000 kinetic with 9/11 and sprinkling. This is just like a book cover, the children of the East, the spiritual heritage of Islam. Someone identifying Islam as being associated with the East. We have that calculation. If you take 391.5, multiply it by 1840, and then divide by 360, you have 2001. So therefore, September 11th, 2001 could relate to the restraining of the four winds and the beginning of the sealing of the 144,000 with the sprinkling of the latter rain, the staying of the rough wind of Isaiah 27, verse 8, or the cry to the angels to continue to hold the four winds represents a tarrying time that then begins. So we have here like a wee diagram. Let's try to explain what I'm saying. Just make it a wee bit bigger. So April 19, 1844, second angel comes down, tarrying time begins. Second angel is announced August 15th, 1844. Other angels come down and join with that and impart it. So it had an impelling power that moved the soul. So we're talking about the midnight cry. So this is, you see this here in the time of Christ. You have after the evening after Christ's resurrection, Christ comes down. He breathes upon his disciples a few drops of the latter rain. Then he says, tarry ye here in the city of Jerusalem. So you have a tarrying time in that their time. Now it's like 40 days afterwards, but it's still in that time period. And then you have Pentecost. You have the plentiful shower. But Elamite talks about when the Holy Spirit comes down and the message is announced. And then with the last generation, you have 11 September 2001. You have an angel coming down, question mark, but, and sort of the evidence there is pointing to that. You have a repeat of the second angel. Repeat of the second angel arrives. You have a sprinkling of the latter rain. The sitting of 144,000 begins. The four winds are restrained. Then we have this here, tarrying time. Hold the four winds. Let the winds tarry until God's people are sealed. You have the Sunday law. And then I saw the latter rain was coming as suddenly as the midnight cry with 10 times the power. And then you have the angel of Revelation 18. The second angel repeated the message announced. Basically, you don't have the message announced here, but you have announced then the Sunday law with a loud cry. And then I have here a proposed parable of the 10 virgins on a line based upon the repeat of Millerite history. So we have Millerite history at the bottom, the time of the end, 1798, parallel with 1989. And then September 11th, so you have that, the first angel empowered and the second, the first disappointment, the second angel arrived, sort of coupled to the same event. So that's April 19, coupled with August 11th, 1840. And that's connecting to the one event of September 11th. You have the messages combined. The first angel empowered, the second angel arrived. You have a tarrying time until the Sunday law, when you have the full outpouring of the latter rain. This is being lined up with midnight. And then all the virgins are awakened. The five with oil fill their lamps, and the lamps of foolish have gone out. So you have the foolish take the mark of the beast. You have the midnight cry, the second angel empowered. And then you have the close probation. Second disappointment, third angel arise, door shut, and then bridegroom returns. Whatever, you can see the diagram, read it for yourself. So, so that's that basically done. And then I've just like a section there at the end where I have Ellen White statements that show that there's a shut door for Seventh-day Adventists at the Sunday law. There's a statement there, she says, as the storm approaches, a large class who have professed faith in the third angel's message join the ranks of the opposition. She calls the time period from the Sunday law to the close of celebration the 11th hour. She calls it the night when stars will be revealed. She calls it the shaking and testing time. She calls it God's destructive judgments. So this is before the seven last plagues. She calls it the time of mercy for those who had no opportunity to learn what is truth. The door is closed to those who would not enter. So that would be Seventh-day Adventists who are foolish virgins. She says, the church appears to fall, but it does not fall. The sinners in Zion are sifted out. There are places immediately filled by others taking hold of the truth. Company after company from the Lord's army join the foe. Tribe after tribe from the ranks of the enemy unite with the people of God. The careless and indifferent are left behind in darkness. So she also has a statement where she says the foolish virgins are left behind, left standing without in the empty street in the blackness of the night. So let's compare that. That's be the dark time then when they're the foolish virgins. And that's that study complete. So any thoughts, questions before we close?
Heavenly Father, we give thanks for your grace and mercy towards us, for bringing us through another year. And I pray that we know you will be with us in 2023. We've been watching events in the world, and we're continuing to seek to look at things with a prophetic eye, in the light of your scripture. Help us to be wise, to discern the events unfolding before us, and that we may be receiving this here latter rain in sprinkling form, knowing that there's going to be a time when a crisis appears. And I pray that we have that oil in our vessels, that it will sustain us through the time of trouble, that we can represent Christ to this here world that is soon to end. And we'll plead for your Holy Spirit in great measure to be with us in the coming year. Your feet guide us, forgive us where we make missteps, but always lead us into your, help us to trust in you. May your light shine upon this year of movement. Help us to discern clearly where you have us and where you're wanting to lead us. Give us further light on our feet towards out there, Holy City. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.